if you are, I see what some of you are doing, you're looking like, yeah, right, we know you, that ain't gonna happen, right? But because of this, we've invited our kids to be in here with us this morning, so they'll get to participate and enjoy with us today. Just to recap a couple of quick things about what's going on in the life of this church. Today, after church, the teen group is coming over to the Nichols house to swim, okay? We got hot dogs, and we invite our teens to bring maybe a 2-liter bottle of pop or a bag of chips. Just get over as soon as you can. We'll have a good, fun time staying cool in the pool. I did that on purpose in there. All right, so teens, swimsuit, towels, sunscreen, those will be helpful, okay? Towels, if you don't have a towel, we got a towel. Sunscreen, we might have that. Swimsuit, you're on your own, okay? So can't help you there, but I hope the plans are coming up in your time with us. Board meeting Tuesday evening. We're trying something different for the next couple of board meetings. We have a board meeting in June. We're skipping July, and then we're going to have a board meeting in August. And we're going to try a different approach to our agenda. And this is what that looks like. At 6:30 instead of 7, we're going to invite our SDMI team and our finance team and then our trustees, which will be our properties and maintenance team, to meet for 45 minutes. Now, what that means is that you don't have to be a board member. If you are a Sunday school teacher, we'd like to have you be here at 6:30. If you are maybe a small group leader and you're able to be here, we'd love to have you part of the conversation. This is going to be part of what we're going to try for just a couple of months and see how it works. And here's the reason why. Because what is at the focal point is the mission of the church. At the focal point of what the mission of this church is to make Christ-like disciples among the nations. And so that's the whole focal point for why we're going to try this. So from 6:30 to 7:15, even if you're not a board member, but if you are a leader, if you are a teacher, if you are handy, if you've been recruited by Cecil to come and sit in on the properties and maintenance, then great. If you've been recruited by Noreen to be a part of the finance team, if you can plan to be here from 6:30 to 7:15. 7:15, I promise you, will be no more. 7:15 is the cutoff, okay? All right? And then you can go throughout your merry way. And then the board will stay for a little bit longer to finish up any meetings that we need to make. All right? So I want to share that with you really quick. All right? All right. Are you ready? 5 minutes. 5 minutes. And then 3 minutes. Okay? We've been talking about the subject of courage. And one of the things that's very, very important for us in this is what's at the focal point. The Lord makes a promise to Abraham way back. For what? There's a promised land. There was a place for his descendants to inhabit. And you go through Abraham, you go through Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, you go through Egypt, you land in the wilderness with Moses for 40 years, and then Joshua leads the people of Israel across the Jordan River into the promised land. And the whole book of Joshua, at its core, is the subject of courage. And courage is defined as the mental or the moral strength to endure, withstand, and persevere danger, difficulty, and fear. The last 9 weeks we have walked through this subject of courage. We began with courage to stand. What's your foundation? What is your footing? Do you stand on the Word of God? Do you stand on His testimony and His history of being faithful? What is a part of that? And we find that courage begins with a sure footing. Then we talked about courage to step. And every one of us has a promised land. Therefore, every one of us has a Jordan River. And the promise to this, the power statement was, when the Lord is first and we step by faith that supernatural things happen. And that's just true. The next week we talk about courage to teach. We talk about how the altar means God met me here. You see, after Joshua led the people of Israel across the Jordan River's dry bed, the Lord instructed him to build an altar of 12 large stones, and that was to say to anybody that came by, God met me here. God saw me through my Jordan River. God saw me into my promised land. But he also built an altar in the middle of the riverbed, as if to say to his obstacle, you ain't got nothing on my God. That's the Monty Dick Revised Standard Version, but that's the gist of it. Next, courage to march. Courage to march. And the people of Israel marched, and they spoke against their enemy stronghold of Jericho. And the truth there is that when the Lord goes first and we step in faith, the Lord will fight for you. That's good for an amen right there. When we step, when the Lord goes first and we step in faith, then the Lord will fight for you. Next, courage to confess. And Cecil presented this very well, the story of Achan and Joshua. And the power statement was simply this: when the Lord goes, if we confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's 1 John 1:9. Next, we talk about courage to honor. Courage to honor, and how courage and honor are synonymous. You can't have courage without honor. You can't have honor without courage. Because honor, when you give honor, then you are living honorably. And when you live honorably, then it's not contingent upon how you give honor. It's the fact that you want to live with honor. And what we find in the story with the Gibeonites is that Israel said, we're going to give honor regardless of the fact that you're not honoring your word. Next, we talk about courage to fight. And the simple power statement is true. I stand on this solidly. The coexistence of differing and opposing worldviews cannot happen without compromising core values. And we found in this story with Joshua how Joshua led the Israelites to, one, defend their honor by protecting the Gibeonites, to defend their land as they were being attacked, and then to attack and take more land, which was their promised land. It was promised to them. They were there to take it. Number 8, we talked about courage to give, and we addressed this out of the Matthew 25:29 passage. To those who use well what they are given, even more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away. In other words, you've got to have courage to give of your time, give of your talent, give of your treasure according to how God leads you to do. And then last week we talked about courage to ask. Courage to ask. And we did a mashup of two verses, John 14:13 and James 4:2b and 3. It says, you can ask anything in my name, and I will do it so that the Son can bring glory to the Father. That's pretty cool. You can ask anything in my name, and the Son will glorify his Father by honoring your request. But you don't have what you want because you don't ask for it. When you ask, you don't get it because your motives are wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure. This is a strong power statement for us. Courage to ask. Did I make 5 minutes? 4? 6? You were timing me. I did pretty good though. 5 out of 6? Come on. All right. So before I begin my 3-minute sermon, I want to pray. Father, we're having fun right now. Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for every promise. God, I thank you for your faithfulness to your church. Today, would you impress your spirit upon us in such a profound way
that we are forever changed. May this, the bride, be found without spot or wrinkle today. And may you be glorified. In Jesus' name. Amen.
You're going to laugh.
But I've got my own time. Okay?
Now, that said, this is what I'm asking you for me, okay? If you're timing me, you can stop. I've got no time. It'll go on, okay? If you've got something else that you're kind of paying attention to right now, I'm going to ask you for 3 minutes. Okay? If you're looking at something else, or if you're talking to somebody, if you're texting, or if you're Facebooking, put it away. We'll give you 3 minutes, right? 3 minutes? Ready? Number 10 is courage to rest. Courage to rest. And here's your power statement. Rest is the product of courage. Rest is the product of courage. We find that in Joshua 21, verses 43 to 45. We find where the Lord gives 3 things to the people of Israel. And I hope you hear me on this. If you don't have spots, so write it in if you would like. One, he gives them a place. So the Lord gave to Israel a place. All the land he has sworn to give their ancestors, and they took possession of it and settled there. Second thing the Lord gave them was provision, rest on every side. They had nothing to worry about. They had no need that they had to be concerned with. Everything they needed was met in that every side, just as he had solemnly promised their ancestors. Number three, protection. Protection. None of their enemies could stand against them, for the Lord helped them conquer all their enemies. Not a single one of all the good promises the Lord had given to the family of Israel was left unfulfilled. Everything he had spoken came true. Courage to rest. Would you like to rest? Would you like to rest? Would you like to know that God has your place in mind? Would you like to know that God has your every need taken care of? Would you like to know that God has his hand of protection on you? Such a rest is a product of courage. And if God's desire is for his people to dwell in his promise, to be strong and take courage, for the Lord will go with you wherever you go. To stand, to step, to teach, to march, to confess, to honor, to fight, to give, to ask, and then ultimately to rest in him. But if his people are not a courageous people, then I have to ask you a question. And I want you to hear every word I say. What in hell are his people afraid of? I'm not being ugly. I'm not being painful. I'm not using vulgarity, because you see, the fact of the matter is that here's something that scares the people of God from being courageous. It is something that comes from the pit of the enemy. And if there's something that prevents us from being courageous, it stems from the gates of hell. 1 John 4:18, such love has no fear, because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, it is for fear of punishment. And this shows that we have not fully experienced his perfect love. A time of love. It's not a rhetorical question. It's not a rhetorical question. It's a solid question. God has intended that the church would walk in courage. And if there's something that prevents you from walking in courage, what is it? What is it? Psalms 129, verse 23 and 24 says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you,
and lead me along the path of everlasting life. What in hell are we afraid of that keeps us from living courageous? So here's what we're going to do. We'll give you a chance to answer. We're going to sing. And I want to leave you from the piano. You folks are welcome to respond however you want. But I might ask you a dual question. If you're mad at me because I've asked the question, I'm sorry. I'm your pastor. You're throwing your friend. But if there's something that prevents you from walking, standing, stepping, marching, confessing, teaching, honoring, giving, asking, fighting, and if you are not resting in this idea that God has your place, your provision, your protection, then I'm going to challenge you to deal with that today. Father God in heaven, would you have your way now? May we deal with this in such a way that it's beautiful.